Welcome to my couch. I have been painting on the couch for the last few days because I hurt my back. So it's much more comfortable than my desk chair. Hopefully it won't last much longer because I feel like I get distracted very easily here because I have this giant window. But it also means that there's beautiful natural light hitting my painting area. I'm going to be painting some apples now. I think it was the same time last year that I posted a video of myself painting apples. And I just like mentioned that I have apples on my mind. I can't stop thinking about painting the apples. I just have to paint them nonstop. And that lasted for a few weeks, just because when I'm walking around outside this time of year, there's fruit trees everywhere. Like all my neighbors have these big apple trees that are covered in bright apples. And the local garden that I go to a lot has pear trees, cherry trees, like all these amazing fruit trees. So it's just on my mind this time of year. And then as September gets cooler and we go into October, that's when the leaves really start to change color. And then I find myself wanting to paint beautiful colored trees and leaves. I'm just going with the flow. I'm kind of in study mode. When you're going through a period of grief and loss, like I know everyone has different ways of coping. One of my ways is to study. So it, you know, in my case with art, I'm doing lots of color studies, drawing, practicing lots of drawing. And it feels good to know that I'm growing my skills, even though I don't feel creative and I don't have really anything to say with my art right now. I am just observing the world and drawing or painting it, and I love knowing I'm growing my skills, so when the time comes and I have something to say and I want to be very creative and paint from the heart, that I'll be ready, you know? I'm embracing study mode, and I thought we would have a chill couch painting session together. Maybe if someone else out there is in couch mode, you can join me. I've already been painting pears for a couple days now. I did a few studies, and then actually this scene I painted again for one of my Patreon tutorials. So if you're interested in like learning how I do something like this step by step, more in a real-time, slow-paced tutorial style, there's a link for that in the description. But today I think we'll just have some fun and sketch together. I like giving myself, leaving room at the top and the bottom just in case I want to do color swatches or notes or anything like that. So I've been really embracing the square format lately. So I've actually been home alone this entire month, the entire month of September, really, because Wolfie's helping one of his family members out of town, and I'm... By the time this video goes live, he'll be back, but it's been a humbling reminder of how hard it is to film myself. So either setting up a tripod and then 20 minutes into the painting realizing it's not in focus, or holding my camera with my left hand, as I usually do, and just trying to stay still, which, to be honest, sounds like the hardest way to do it, but it's actually the easiest because I just forget I'm holding it. And eventually my arm gets a little tired and then I'm like, oh yeah, I have a camera in my hand. Since I've been home alone though, I've been watching all the shows that he wouldn't want to watch, but I've run out of shows to watch. So if anyone has any good suggestions, like binge-worthy shows, I just finished Wheel of Time. I've been pretty busy though because I'm about to launch my gouache brush set, which I've mentioned once or twice, and I'll be launching it on October 15th. I'll make a video, not this coming weekend, but the next weekend, about it. All right, I figured out how to set up the camera so that I'm not holding it the entire time. Actually, right before I sat down to paint, I got an email from someone with a suggestion for a video. And usually I have my videos planned out weeks in advance, like what I want to say and what I'm going to do, everything. But in this case, you know, I just wanted to sit down and have a casual chat with everyone. So I was like, maybe I will talk about that. But anyway, what their suggestion or question was is, how do you choose when to use unique color combinations, like something that you wouldn't necessarily find in nature? How do you decide when to be stylized? And I kind of had to stop for a second and remember that that in itself is a skill that you learn as you go. And I'm still learning it. Every time I paint, I learn something, and I even learn what I like and what I don't like. So you're always going to be developing your own taste. I don't think there's a formula for it, so it's hard to answer that question. But I do know from experience that it evolves in over time. So when I first started painting, what I loved is not what I love doing now, or the colors I like now are different. And it all just comes from that time and effort. And I do critique myself a lot. So I look at what I do and I assess whether I like it, what I don't like, and I try to improve upon it each time, which I think that really helps. There are some things I think about in terms of color while I'm painting, and there's sort of two ways I would approach it. One way is what I'm doing now is a study. So I am looking at my reference photo and remembering what it felt like to be there in person. So one way you can approach color is to change one little aspect that you see in the photo to when you paint it. So maybe in the photo, the leaves are bright green, but I want to make them more of a muted green. Maybe I want to change the shadows on my apples to more purplish blue, just to see what happens. Because if I don't see it happen on my paper, I'll never know for sure. The other approach you could take is to be more methodical about it and do the same painting multiple times, but change certain things in each rendition. So one painting, you will use normal colors or what you try to match the reference photo as best you can. Maybe in one, you'll do pink shadows. Maybe in one, you'll do purple shadows and blue shadows, and each time. And then you have all of those paintings, compare them side by side, and you know which, you'll automatically know which one you like better. You kind of gravitate towards certain color combinations. We all have our preferences. And from that, you'll know next time you want to do this style or this color combination. Maybe you've seen another artist use color combination that you never thought of and that appeals to you and you want to give it a try. Go for it. Like, there's nothing stopping you. Doing a master study is another really great way to explore colors, because when you do a master study, you're copying the work of someone who is usually like very far in their career, because, you know, they're a master artist. That is one of the most amazing ways to learn how to see differently, because you're sort of seeing how they see by doing what they're doing. Obviously, when you do a master study, you shouldn't ever just do it and then claim it as your own because you're copying someone else, but you learn a lot from it. And that's definitely a technique they teach you in art school, how to see through someone else's eyes almost. I think one thing I could benefit from is doing more detailed studies, but I think lately I've just been in this mode of go, go, go. Like, I've been going on so many hikes and walks, and it's just a constant influx of information. I'm on this studying binge, but my only goal really is to just improve my own way of seeing and my technical skills, and that's a never-ending thing. So I could be doing this for my entire life. But yeah, I tend to do these more quick, loose studies. That in itself is how I'm training myself to be able to do quicker studies so that I can go outside and paint quickly on location. Like, I look forward to that every summer, being able to go out long walks, long hikes, and paint from life. But if I don't ever practice making these quick, loose studies, and which require a lot of quick consecutive decisions, I get out of practice really quick, and then I go outside and I feel like a fish out of water. So while I know there are tons of benefits to doing very, very detailed studies and studying something more realistically, I can't help but constantly feel like I should be training myself for doing the thing I love doing the most. Does that make sense? I don't know. But it means that after weeks of studies, endless hours sitting there painting something from reference photos inside, that I just have a plethora of kind of okay studies. Like, nothing is really worthy of hanging up or framing or selling or putting on a postcard. Like, I can't help but feel like, oh, maybe I should be trying harder to make work that I can do something with, you know, instead of just a huge pack or stack of work that's only useful for the fact that I learned something. I don't know. I'm just rambling at this point, guys. Just bear with me. I can't help. Like, I'm not going to change what I'm doing just because I think it will sell or something, because I have this goal of being able to paint more fluidly on location. That requires so much brush mileage. Like, I just have to sit here and do it over and over again and make these quick little studies. There's no way around it. So I know what I'm doing is right, but I can't, you know, I sometimes wonder, like, oh. I think that's a side effect of being online and being bombarded by social media, seeing what other people are doing. You know, I mean, a lot of you will know what I mean by that. Like, it's just how it is when you're online, comparing yourself to others, which, again, I say it in almost every freaking video, don't do it. But it's really hard not to. I mean, how can you not? It's just like this thing that happens in our brain without realizing it almost. I'm really embracing this quinacridone magenta in certain bits. But I'm trying to not overdo that saturation. In my Patreon tutorial that I mentioned earlier, I talk about how I keep the colors a little bit more muted and realistic, and that's not the point of this study. With this study, I'm just like playing. I want to see what happens when I do sort of stylized apples. I'm definitely using more of a purpley undertone. When my girlfriends were in town recently, I literally lost my voice because I'm not used to talking so much. It was ridiculous. Before I moved to Scotland and I was like in my full-time job and speaking to hundreds of people every day, it felt like, even back then, I always remember going home at the end of the night and my throat was like sore. And then when I quit my job and I became self-employed, I was still streaming a lot. I was still making a lot of videos and talking to people. But over the years, I've slowly become more of a hermit, I guess you'd say. And I choose my social situations very carefully. And because of that, it's like my vocal cords have just become so, I just don't use them as much as I should or could. And then when I do use them a lot, like when I have visitors and I'm talking nonstop for several days, oh my goodness, I notice it. The amount of strain on my vocal cords is ridiculous. Does anyone else go through that? Go through this? It seems like such a weird problem to describe. Like, I need to work out my vocal cords? What? What? Okay, now that I have my underpainting done, I can start to play with fun dry brush textures. I find it really helpful to just fill in the majority of the painting with something, and then coming back in with more layers and textures and maybe more of the final, obviously the final colors will be on top of everything, but yeah, just getting something on the page is really, really useful. One thing I find really fun about gouache, which is one of the trickier things about it, is how put a color down and it dries much darker or a little bit lighter. You know, basically the color shift that happens or the value shift after it dries. And the more you paint, the more you use certain color combinations and figure out like the water content in your brush strokes and everything like that, you do get much better figuring out how much it's going to change. And it's not such a surprise, but there are times when I'm like, what? That changed drastically. Usually the more white involved in the mix, the more drastically the color shift or the value shift is. If you want to learn how to do dry brush, painting fruit skin is one of the best subjects. When you look at an apple or so many different types of fruit, you see, when you really look at the skin, you see how much variety there is in every like millimeter of it. It's anything but a solid color. So yeah, you can have a lot of fun with that. I made this like custom sandy color, just call it sand, in my palette, and it's really perfect for these dusty highlights on the apples. Oh, is anyone doing Inktober? And if so, do you have any good prompt lists you're following? I thought about doing it, and I thought about making my own prompt list. I've done that in the past, but I have too much going on right now. I know that I wouldn't be able to keep up with it. So I'm just gonna be watching and living vicariously through others. I'll probably do some ink sketching because I always get inspired during Inktober. But yeah, it would be cool to hear, because I know certain prompt list creators will make like specific hashtags, and then you can follow those hashtags on Instagram or something and then keep up with whoever's posting in it. And that's really fun. I like that. I've been trying to get better at posting on Instagram and failing. Like, it's weird how it's, I mean, it is such a time suck to be on Instagram or any kind of social media. So I did cut back a lot in the last year, which has been great, but I do want to post more. It's just whenever I sit down to post, I'm like, oh, well, I haven't posted in a while. Is this really what I want to post after like a month of not posting? And then I question myself and yeah. Wolfie's really good. He's like, just post it. Who cares? Just post it. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. Maybe this is interesting to anyone else who doesn't post a lot or wondering if they should post less but worried about the algorithm. My statistics have shown me that even though I've posted less over the last year, my growth hasn't slowed down. I think it's because I've posted less but like higher quality content, and I guess it just gets picked up by the algorithm. And I don't know. I mean, my account is by no means growing rapidly. Like, it's just that it's not growing slower than it used to. I used to post a lot and it didn't make that much of a difference. Actually, it did make a difference on my mental health. So I will gladly take slightly slower growth over what I used to feel. What am I doing? What am I doing? What are you on about? I'm just like putting marks down and I'm not even thinking anymore. What am I doing? Why? Just stop. Why can't you stop painting? Okay. Well, I guess I'm gonna just end the session here and we'll do another one another day. This was fun. Thanks for hanging out with me. I hope you got some work done. Got some sketching in maybe. And wow, that fades so quickly. My mark, which seemed really bright at first, is not bright at all. Oh yeah. All right. Gonna leave now. Bye.